I was shocked to realize that you're turning 70 in a year.
No, actually 72 in a year.
I still think of you as like 40 or 25
well,
or something.
I'm very pleased. Well, it's much nice to be thought of as 40.
Do you feel, is it changing how you work as you get a little older?
Not really. I mean, I think because I've been pretty much stuck here because I have a six-year-old, I haven't been able to like travel around quite so much. So I've done films probably that have been slightly more archival than the other, because I used to shoot everything, right? So probably spent less time on location.
Well, this film is unusually lacking Nick Broomfield in it.
Yeah, well, there's bits, but you know, different kind of film.
Mostly in voice, occasional voice comments you're making.
Yeah, and I guess, you know, some photographs of myself in a much earlier incarnation.
So was that, was the relationship, was your relationship the impetus for this particular film?
Well, it was, yeah. I was 20 when I met Marianne on Idra, and I hadn't heard of Leonard Cohen at that time. But I was at a point in my life where I was actually studying to be a barrister, a lawyer in England. I was at university studying that. But a bit kind of, you know, like 20-year-olds looking around, wondering what to do, wondering if what they really wanted to do. And meeting Marianne and being on Idra, which is a kind of magical island, was a very influential part of my life in making me probably change direction and deciding that I was going to make my first film. And Marianne was very encouraging. I don't know that I wouldn't have done one eventually anyway, but she, I think, you know, before you make your first film or anything, you're full of doubt. You come up with an equal number of reasons why you shouldn't do something as much as why you should. And she was one of those very encouraging people who always was, you know, believe in yourself, sort of follow your ideas through, of course you can do it kind of thing, which, was very helpful. And obviously she introduced me to Penny Baker's work and so on. He'd been on Idra the year before. He had just made that film, Don't Look Back, about Dylan. And obviously was a kind of mentor in terms of being a documentary filmmaker.
So your style is rather different than his style, ultimately.
Yeah.
Was that the foundation or the idea of being a documentarian, or did you take more specific things from him or choose other paths? Or
I think in my early work was very influenced by the work of Penny Baker and Wiseman. The work was much more observational, kind of cinema verite. And it was only later that I started putting myself into the films and making a more kind of confrontational kind of film, or a more Inspector Clouseau kind of film, depending on how you look at them. But when I was working with Joan Churchill at the beginning, it was much more in the style of Penny Baker and Fred Wiseman.
So was there something that turned a corner for you that changed how you do
it? Yeah, I was making a film about a Broadway show in New York. And all the financing started falling to bits. And there was a very debonair and eccentric producer called Andrew Brownsburg, who'd done a whole lot of films with Warhol and a few films with Polanski, who had convinced people to depart with many millions of dollars to make this film. Then they suddenly realized that they'd given him all this money. They didn't have a script. They had no idea actually what was going to happen. And they all started wanting their money back, or bits of the money back. And so I had kind of said, well, Andrew, I'm going to go back to England, to, you know, to my home. And he said, well, look, we're staying in the best hotel in New York. What are you going to do for the next 2 months? Why don't we make something? Let's try and make something completely experimental that's never been made before. And I thought about it. And in the morning, I said, Andrew, okay, if you will agree to be in the film and I can film all your crazy conversations with the financiers and stuff, and film sort of in a way kind of not just be doing a film about the show, but make a film about the makings of the film and all the complications you're going through, I think that it's the only way I can, because you might have your financing pulled out at any moment.
Right.
So I'll have a beginning, middle, and end, at least if... He reluctantly agreed, and then I discovered, you know, I used it more in subsequent films, like The Leader, The Driver, which was a sort of portrait of the Adolf Hitler of South Africa at the time of Mandela. I realized you could make a much funnier kind of film, because so much of life is ridiculous and funny anyway, and so much of making films is very revealing of the people. And I think very often traditional filmmaking, you just sort of do the interview and you don't show all the things that the people don't want to talk about. And often the things that people don't want to do and don't want to talk about and are making a big fuss about are the most revealing things, rather than the things they are prepared to talk about. So I started making a different kind of film, a film that was very much more revealing, I felt, in a way, because it was kind of, a lot of it was about the difficulties of a film. The difficulties of Courtney Love trying to stop us making the film about Kurt Cobain, which involved losing the financing from MTV and causing endless problems on the production. But it was very, very revealing of her,
right,
and how she operated, and gave a really strong portrait of her and her world, which is obviously a very different way of making a film, and I suppose at that time was a very new way of making a film, you know.
So the first film was it's the black musical, right?
It's called Driving Me Crazy.
Driving Me Crazy, yeah. Which I've seen many times, actually. And it's a remarkable film because there, particularly there are a few of the characters who are involved with the show who are seemingly unintentionally expose themselves. I think they feel like they have a righteous indignation about different things,
right,
and yet it comes across as kind of a level of insanity.
Yeah. So
in another film, in another documentary about the making of, I mean, it's like there's a show within a show, which is kind of fascinating in that case.
Yeah.
But did you find as you were doing it that you were getting stuff that would usually be the thing that happened after you turned off the camera? Was that the revelation?
Yes, exactly. It was all the stuff you would normally would end up, as they would say then, on the cutting room floor, was really what ended up in the film. All the difficulties and problems and bad-tempered moments or hysterical moments were in the film. And it gave a very revealing portrait of the insanity of those Broadway shows, rather than it just being a sort of celebration of the triumph of the show. It showed all the ups and downs of putting the show together and the different egos, and the film crew didn't help very much. They would contribute by fusing all the lights, not only in the for the show, but the entire block, more or less. Very much, I think, a showbiz portrait.
So did people figure out that Nick Broomfield, I mean, it's funny, there's a Mike Wallace documentary coming out in a few weeks that in some ways Nick Broomfield is here, is almost as scary as Mike Wallace is here, I think, for some people. I mean, did people figure out if Nick is interested in doing a film about you, you better be careful?
I noticed that there weren't a lot of people ringing me up saying, would you like to do a film about me? Well, you know, would you like to do a film about this band that we're, you know, representing?
Right.
I noticed there wasn't that kind of thing happening at all. I think I was once offered a film in a tax office, but that was about it, and it was really pretty boring. I noticed it was a good idea not to use my name when I was asking if I could make a film, getting permission and so on.
Interesting.
Yeah.
So did you...
But maybe that will change now, you know.
Well,
I think the film about Marianne Leonard is a very loving film. It's a love story, really. So it's a change of direction.
Yeah.
In a way, it's a very personal film. I think it's a film about enduring love, and it's a tender film. So
have you gotten feedback from the Leonard Cohen camp, or from any of the people who were obsessed with him, or?
People who are his fans love the film. I'm not speaking for the estate
right
there, But
how does the estate feel?
Well, I don't know. You have to ask the estate that. Right. I would hate to presume to speak for them. Mm-hmm. But people who are his fans and people who probably know a lot more about Leonard Cohen than I do absolutely love the film. I think I can say that. I can't think of anybody who has come up and said, you really should have done this or done that, or I'm disappointed. It was, you know, the audiences we've had, there haven't been a lot, but there have been probably five or six sold out screenings that we've done so far, and they've all been incredibly positive. And people at the end come and talk about very much about their own loves, their own very personal anecdotes and so on.
You really cover his life as kind of a growth thing. There's really nothing negative about him outside of some people would say the facts of his life were, you know, a little dicey, but
yeah,
you're not harsh about them or judging them in the movie at all.
And I think he was also a artist who resonated on a very personal level with his audience. He hit a very interior part of their makeup. So they held him in a very special place, or they hold him in a very special place, I would say. They've reacted to the film very much on that level, I think.
Well, it's interesting that you had the relationship you have with Marianne, because a lot of your film, at least half a dozen, I'd say, of your films, do have the kind of muse and artist thing going on.
Yeah, that's true.
For better or for worse. A lot of the films, it comes out pretty badly, sadly, for the artist, or even for the muse sometimes. But it's an interesting thing that
Well, I suppose in the film, too, about Whitney,
yeah.
You know, Robin was very much the muse, I guess, and a very strong and very positive influence, I think, on Whitney. I guess she's doing her own thing. So it'd be interesting to see what she comes up with.
So was it odd to have that, your film and the Kevin MacDonald film, coming out around the same time with slightly different ideas of what the punchline was?
Yeah, he had all this stuff about abuse.
Yeah.
Which I absolutely don't think is in any way possible.
Hmm.
So I was pretty dubious about that. But apart from that, I think he pretty much traced exactly what I had traced a year and a half earlier.
Yeah. Do you think that's it? I mean, I think one of the phenomena of having so many people making films now with, you know, the cameras that are available and everything else is that I'm seeing more and more that there are two or three documentaries to fill out the story. You know, like each one has a specific perspective and then you want to see this one. I mean, the fire documentaries that were on Hulu and Netflix were kind of the most amazing examples.
Yeah.
Where there were very different films about the same exact thing.
Well, I think everybody's a different storyteller. So they're going to tell films in a different way, in a different form, with a different emphasis depending on their interest. You know, I suppose the only thing I would say with those two films is whether certain events actually happened or not,
right.
Rather than the interpretation of them.
Yeah.
You know, and I had obviously spent the better part of 2.5 years researching that, so I knew all the various protagonists pretty well, and I also knew certain things that were more murky that I hadn't actually necessarily put in the film because I didn't think that they were incredibly helpful, but went in a very different direction to the assertions that Kevin made in his film.
So do you feel, do you have a community of documentarians with whom you are social or whatever? I mean, do you feel like you're part of a group of that?
I would say on the whole, documentary filmmakers are pretty loyal to each other. I think Netflix has brought in an element of competition that hasn't been there before. They're the sort of Harvey Weinsteins of the documentary community who spend vast sums of money to try and secure themselves Oscars, which I think is very different from the kind of history and, I would say, language of the documentary community up to this particular time. And some of it, I think, is quite distasteful. I mean, I'm in the Academy, so you kind of get a pretty good view of what's going on. And I think, you know, when you have people spending 20, 30 million to try and push a film, you know, of a documentary feature, you know, that's a different language to what we've been used to.
Mm. So does that mean you don't want to participate in that revenue stream?
Well,
that's kind of the big challenge of the Academy,
that
too.
That 30 million is not going into filmmaking. It's going into promoting the film. Probably, you know, the irony is probably the budget of the film was 5 million or 6 million. Or 2 million, you know.
Yeah.
I think the emphasis, it's a skewed emphasis, you know, and I think ideally those kinds of awards should be going to merit rather than who can throw the most cocktail parties.
Hmm. Well, you've not been a beloved of the award universe, really, have you?
Well,
you've gotten a few.
It's certainly never been my, I've certainly never done anything. I've done things because I've been interested or I've seen an interesting story. I wouldn't say that my motivation has been to clutter my mantelpiece with bits of bronze.
Well, but you certainly have films that are, you know, legendary, really. I mean, as much as the Maisels, as much as Herzog, you know, as much as the people that get that kind of that position, you know, and they've turned out to be, people question them often when they come out and then they're prescient, you know, 5 years later, it turns out you were on the right track. Yeah. And everybody else was kind of looking somewhere else.
Yeah, well, yeah, I think that's probably a more interesting, it's that sort of history. You know, it's obviously gratifying that you've got films that were made probably 25 years ago that are still playing on, you know, the platforms, Netflix, Amazon, and so on. That still have a relevance today. And I've had a lot of the films remastered. So they're, you know, originally they're in the 16:9 format.
Mm-hmm.
And shooting on 16mm is a very beautiful format. And I think if you go back to the original negative, as we've done on with about 30 of the films, they take on an incredible relevance because, well, they look very beautiful. They look better than they've ever looked with modern technology, you know, if you can reduce the grain and so on.
Right.
And I think it gives them a relevance today, a continuing relevance. You know, they don't look all grainy and like you're looking at some piece of ancient history.
Well, they're also just fantastic. I mean, getting people to them sometimes is more challenging than anything else. But, you know, I don't know how you can watch the Eileen Wuornos film, you know, the Charlize Theron movie, Munster, without going back to watch your film.
Mm.
You know, and then you watch your film and it's kind of breathtaking in a whole different way.
Well, I guess the great thing about all the platforms that are in existence today is that it's much easier than going to a video store or, you know, they're much more accessible. And I think there is an interest in some of the older documentaries and so on. They're much more readily available than they've ever been before.
Well, even like the Chicken Ranch film and the S&M Club in New York and all that stuff.
Yeah.
It's like, if you're interested in New York in the 80s,
yeah,
you got to go watch that one. Yeah. You got to, I mean, these are all, it's interesting that documentaries are having that kind of resurrection.
Yeah.
Because there are history. I mean, essentially.
Yeah.
They're living history.
Yeah. And it's very interesting how, I mean, I was watching a film I did years ago, actually the first one that Joan and I did together, which was in a place called Blackburn, which I suppose is famous from the Beatles song, you know. How many holes does it
take? The Albert Hall.
What was it?
The holes are filling the Albert Hall.
Yeah, well, where was the Blackburn, Lancashire one? Anyway, Maybe I've got the wrong one.
No, Blackburn, Lancashire is in there too.
It was definitely there, yeah. Wasn't it?
Yes.
Anyway, we did a film about the police dealing with juveniles, which is a pretty horrific film, which actually got banned for 30 years. And what's amazing is not only the haircuts, but the wallpaper, which people had in their houses then. I mean, it's so crazy. And just the interior design of houses was just so different. And yeah, and certainly the way of relating to children. I think we shot that film in the mid-70s. And it's just a different universe. You really do feel that so many of our values and attitudes have shifted incredibly since that time.
Well, I haven't seen, I guess you did a series for the BBC on disappearing England or something?
About disappearing buildings.
Ah.
Yeah, called Going, Going, Gone. It was rather, we only actually did two buildings, but...
That sounds like a similar...
Yeah,
take
it was,
on
it was,
the world.
Yeah, it was very interesting. It was great to do. I think documentary does have a way of showing how we view different views of the world, different times.
Well, you're kind of looking now these days, particularly for something concrete that's has an authoritative voice to hang on to. Given how every piece of information now is erasable and changes every 30 seconds. Reality is a question mark these days more than ever.
Yeah.
So this film, how long did you spend doing Marianne and Leon?
Leonard.
You change his name.
Well, I don't know. It was probably made over a couple of years. I was probably doing another film as well at the same time. Because a lot of it was very research intensive, finding material.
Right.
And we found footage that was in people's attics that they'd never processed from Idra, Super 8 footage. And then we found all that Pennybaker footage that had never been seen of Marianne. And then we had to find so literally hundreds of radio interviews that they'd both done. Mm. And with Marianne, it was especially difficult because she hadn't done that many. Some of them were in Norwegian. So we had to get those and obviously translate them. And yeah, I mean, I think when you're doing something that's heavily archived, it just takes a lot of time.
Does the story come together as clearly as when you're there with the camera on your back or the sound equipment on your back and in the middle of it? Or
well, actually, the film is more editing intensive,
right?
Archival films. And it is a different way of working. I mean, the first one I'd really done was the Whitney film. Mm-hmm. And it took us a really long time because we made all the mistakes possible on it. But then you learn from those mistakes. And so the subsequent one, on Leonard Cohen, went much faster. Mm-hmm. You do structure more of a story, I guess, with those films. You kind of work out a bare-bones story, and then you obviously need to be very fluent with the archive in order to help tell the story. Mm-hmm. It's a slightly different way of working. I think what's very interesting is the interplay of words and image. So it's not just, talking heads, I think, are interesting when somebody is telling something quite personal, or they're particularly animated, or they're telling you a vital part of the story, the emotional story, rather than just giving information. And other than that, I think a lot of the words are more interesting over images, often much more powerful. Right. And I think the audience, people looking at it, then create their own images when they're looking at it. It gives the audience more of a chance to develop their own imagination, I think just talking heads can be much too literal,
So as you evolve into this new form and get used to it, are you looking at other pieces and how they were done? Are there music films or other, I mean, or do you just know them
not
anyway?
Not really. I mean, I think the work of, it's completely slipped my mind. The filmmaker who did Senna and
Asif Kapadia.
What was it? Asif. I mean, I think his work was very interesting because, you know, it's entirely archival.
Right.
And he doesn't really have any. He doesn't really have any talking heads at all. Mm-hmm. His is all images. And I think his work is very beautifully edited. And it's much more interesting than the more traditional way of telling those stories.
Well, you really, there is a poetry to what you're, I mean, he has his own kind of brand and he does interesting, I mean, the Amy documentary is amazing also in a different kind of way, but your film, particularly this film, is very poetic and it's kind of, it is watching the evolution of an artist.
Yeah.
In many ways, and this kind of intimate artist who's a reluctant artist, and it's kind of a fascinating look into it.
Yeah, it is. And then, of course, one tries to use music and sounds in a very creative way. I mean, that's what I love about doing these films, is that you learn so much on each one. And hopefully you put what you learn into the next one, you know, and so it's very much an evolving thing.
So it has changed for you over the years?
Oh, yeah, enormously. And just the kind of stories one wants to tell change a lot.
Mm-hmm. Are you mellowing?
I don't know if, I'm certainly telling more personal stories. I actually just did a film about my father, which was slightly more than I bargained for. I mean, it was very emotional and very difficult to have a perspective on it. But in a way, the Marianne Leonard film prepared me for it, because that was much more personal too than what I've been doing,
right.
And much more a love story, you know. I think people really like love stories because they can relate to them on a very I guess it's a very significant emotion for all of us.
Well, if you have a signature, a lot of it has been, I think, finding passion in places that people don't necessarily expect to find passion.
Yeah.
You know, even in the disconnection of people emotionally, you find what's driving them.
Yeah, I mean, I found making the Eileen Wuornos story very, very emotionally affecting, which I never expected at the time. Because there was something about her that I found enormously appealing and sympathetic. But I guess the film about Marianne Leonard and the one about my father is much more directly to do with enduring love and frustrated love and those kind of tensions that happen between people who are very emotionally involved with each other.
Well, you've done it's interesting. I mean, it is interesting because you are very aggressive, I think, or have been in your work a lot of the time, but you also aren't a judge. You don't judge the way that people would expect judgment to happen. I mean, it always feels like you're just asking the question because there's a question there that you know needs to be asked.
Yeah.
So you're willing to ask it when other people would just shut up and, you know, find it somewhere in there.
I think films like The Curtain Courtney, Biggie and Tupac and so on have been much more like detective stories where you're trying to undercover information, where you're trying, you know, and those are probably more, it's a more aggressive form of telling a story because you're like a dog who's in pursuit of a bone, you know, is the fuel for telling that story. And I guess these other stories which are more portraits of relationships, the frustrations and the ups and downs. Yes, they're more straightforward.
Well, it sounds like you're doing that work off camera, like talking about doing the film about your dad. It sounds like whatever challenges you were trying to figure out about your relationship or him or whatever, you were doing in the editing bay or in your mind, not with a camera on your back or a mic pack.
Yeah, probably. I mean, my father was a photographer. He's having a big exhibition, actually, at the Victoria and Albert Museum in London next year, which is what got me to do the film. But he, being a photographer, he had a massive archive of photographs, as well as little movie things. Mm. And my family had been very, well, my uncle did all those early programs with David Attenborough. So it was a lot of archive in the family, which, so again, that was very archival going through it and, putting that together in terms of our relationship.
So you've been, your films have almost all been either pre-sold or in theatrical situations.
Yes, yeah.
This film, are you going into films now thinking presetting theatrical or assuming theatrical or aiming at theatrical? Or
not just... really. No, not really. No. I wish I was that organized, but I just do things because I think they make a good story or that I'm they're a challenge. Or in this case, it was two people who are very significant at a particular point in my life, you know.
So is the funding affected by all of that?
Well, I guess some subjects are more obviously commercial.
Right. I would think Leonard's Following makes this somewhat, certainly a cult commerciality.
Yeah, I guess so. Yeah, I would imagine. Probably more so than my father. Mm. You know.
But do you have, is that a consideration for you as you pick subjects, or has it been over the years? Or?
Not really, no. I mean, Tales of the Grim Sleeper was not a particularly commercial idea, but I thought that it would make a great story. Mm. Some of them are hard to sell. I mean, Tales of the Grim Sleeper, which is about South Central Los Angeles, has wonderful people in it, great characters. But I think, because they're not stars and we're such a celebrity driven culture, it's a harder sell, you know.
So when you're done with your film after a couple of years and it's coming out in theaters, what is your relationship with it after that? Does it become part of your past, or does it linger with you for a while, or?
I think, all the films are they're pretty personal. I'm very keen on I have a library of films. I've never given up the copyright to my films to anybody else, which is kind of why I would have a hesitation, for example, working for a Netflix commission, because you don't have copyright. It belongs to them. Whereas I've got, 33 feature-length films, which are all part of my library. And I think that's important. I know people like Fred Wiseman, and has meticulously kept his
Fred's obsessed with
archive.
It.
Yeah, and I think that's a wonderful
thing. And Werner,
thing.
Too. Werner has a big, the archive of the early stuff particularly.
Which I think is a wonderful thing to do.
Yeah.
Because I think your work feeds from each other. And I've got so many friends who made really fantastic films, but for very different TV companies who owned the films. Mm-hmm. And half of them ended up just being thrown into a skip, especially when the labs all move from film.
Right.
And they, because of that, they're unable to update them and remaster them. Mm. So I think a lot of films have just sort of, disappeared.
Yeah, the story about the Universal Music Library that burned down is horrifying. So much of Hollywood is horrifying because we've lost so much of everything
so
for 100 years.
Exactly. But. It's just like, very transient. So it probably requires the person who did the films to build up their own library and to,
And you're not a retirer. You're not going away anytime.
I sadly can't afford to retire with a 6-year-old.
You're building the next generation now.
Well,
because your son works with you also. Your older son.
My eldest son. Yeah. I haven't managed to get Charlie to carry any equipment around yet.
He has to be a little bit bigger to carry the heavy stuff.
A little bit more obedient.
Cameras are getting smaller.
Well, tell him to carry something. He's more likely to go in the opposite direction at the moment.
Well, he's like his dad.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. Thanks.
Thank you.